before we start getting into the details of the process and techniques and everything, we'll try and see what happens in a typical software application development. We, in the previous parts, what we did is we tried to simulate and compare it with, or rather look at the software development process vis-a-vis construction process. Okay. Here we will look at in totality and see how does a software application gets developed and what are the different things which happen in different phases of the software development life cycle. So as we have already discussed, the software development process starts with business requirements. That means the customer starts with saying, I want to get this software developed, or I want to automate a particular business process. That's the version of the business or the customer, and that is known as business requirements. So business requirements come in different flavors. Some of them could be pretty detailed ones. Some of them could be one-liners. Some of them could be in between, very detailed one versus one-liners. Okay. So let's say this is the business version of the software requirement. This is for LPG connection application. So for simplicity purpose, I have chosen a very small requirement, which is if you want to get an LPG connection, you can use this application to apply for it. Okay. So the customer says, I want a software which will have a single form to accept the application for new LPG connections. Okay. And as a, when somebody is applying for it, that person should be providing us the following information. First is name, various things. I mean, it's a salutation will clarify whether it's a male or female, first name, middle name, last name, state, district, and distributor, because distributor is the actual person who actually distributes the licenses. Date of birth, mobile number, email ID. Okay, so that's something which you might receive from the customer in terms of requirements. So this requirement is known as either business requirement, or sometimes this comes in a document which is known as BRD, B for Bombay. So which is known as business requirements document. Okay. What happens next? Next is, you will then start interacting with the customer to understand the requirements better. Okay. So the entire process of requirements gathering, understanding, analysis, modeling, and then documenting is an elaborate process, and that is completely conducted by either business analyst, single person, or multiple people, but led by business analyst. So when you are talking to the customer, you have to look at it from software development perspective, that you need to get more information so as to get it or make it relevant for the developers as well. So now see what information has been added here. So the application form will capture details individually for state-wise and city-wise distributor. In the business requirement, there is a state, district, and distributor, but this relevant connection was not established. When you talk to the customer, you have this new information saying that distributor will always be city-wise, and city is always connected to state. Now, how will each applicant be identified? On discussion with the customer, you realize that it should be by mobile numbers. The first name is mandatory. That means if you have to submit the form for a new LPG connection, okay, you need to provide your first name. Otherwise, system will not accept your application. Second condition, that duplicate forms will not be accepted. Now, when you say duplicate forms, how will you determine duplicate forms? That will be on the basis of
mobile numbers.
Correct. Because that's the unique identification for every applicant. Okay. So after you have kind of detailed the requirements, so how people detail the requirements, this happens through various techniques which we discussed briefly about in the problem solving method, where to identify the root cause or to identify the problem definition, you either interview, you either send questionnaires to the customer, you look at the available documents which are with the customer. So many techniques are used to get the details for the requirements. So part one of this is to detail the business requirements which you have received. Next, which typically is done is to model the business process. So what you have done is, it's a simple three-step process as to how LPG connection application workflow will work. So the user will submit the application. This will go to somebody who will check the application before it goes to the distributor. Right? So now you can see that even though it customer says it's a single form application, but there is a separate step here, which is check application. Now, the check application will involve somebody from the LPG company has to check this application, or somebody from the distributor side. No, not the distributor side. Just before that has to check before it goes to the distributor. Okay. So that's an additional thing which has come up once you have started to get a little more detail of the requirements. Okay. So that is something which is the second part, which is typically done while doing the requirements elaboration and detail. Third part, again, part of the modeling. So when we looked at the process and we created the model for the process, this is called process modeling because we are modeling the process. Flowchart is one of the techniques to use it. Or you can simply use this kind of a method to model a process. A little more as far as modeling is concerned is to create the dummy screens for a particular form or a particular application. So if you're doing it for an application, there could be multiple forms. If you're doing it in this case, there's a single form. Okay. So this screen, once somebody makes this, it very clearly now gives a picture as to how this application will look like, how people will start interacting with it. Right now, the coding part is not done. Now, if you look at this, you say that state is a drop-down list from where the state will be selected. So I am from Maharashtra, so we'll select Maharashtra. Then automatically the district names will change based on the state selected. Third is the distributor as to in a selected district, maybe Mumbai is a district, who are the distributors who are available? So that will come. In the prototype, there is a suggestion that instead of going through the entire three process, why can't we directly locate a distributor by typing the name of the distributor? Then the full name, then date of birth, mobile number, email ID. Okay. So this is the screen prototype or screen model, which is created during the requirements phase. Again, these steps are not mandatory and they are not done in every case. So depending on the scenario, you can get these prototypes done, or you may skip this. Or typically what happens is the screen prototyping is done for a selected set of screens, not for all of them. Some of them are very obvious, or some of them which may not require customer interaction. They might be admin screen. It's creating some masters. For example, here, if you see this, if this is a drop down, and this is a drop down, and this is a drop down, you need to have some screen in the back end which will enter the names of the distributors. Right? That screen is not something which is frequently used by applicants. It's maybe one time entry, or maybe once in a while later on you can add a new distributor or edit a previous one. So the frequency of use of distributor list is very low. So in that case, that may not be a candidate for prototype. You may not build it at all. Okay, you just directly go and get it developed by the tech guys. Okay, so the third part of the entire requirement phase is to get the screen design also. Once all of this has been done, then from a business analysis perspective, you need to provide a little more detail. Okay, this is more relevant for the technology team. Okay, now what we have done here is, whatever fields were available on the screen, state, district, distributor, that has been put in a table. Then we are saying, what is the type of this? So when you say choice, that means it's a drop-down box from where applicant can choose one. If you are allowing checkboxes and multiple values can be selected, you'll have to write multi-choice. Then first name is a text field, middle name is a text field, date of birth is a date field, mobile number is a number field, email ID is an email or text. Size meaning, what is the size of that field? So sometimes you may not be very sure about what is the size. Okay, discussing with customer and suggesting them the best practices. Because first name, middle name and last name is something which is which has been created on multiple screens by multiple companies on multiple systems. Okay, so there is always a standard which is acceptable for first name, middle name and last name. 45 is one of the standards for name categories, name fields. Date of birth, what is the size? So here if you put it like this, so DD, MM and 4Ys. Mobile number 10 characters, email ID 100 characters. Okay. Then there are certain rules which are associated with every field. Okay, for example, state. Now state is a reference data. Why? Because it's coming from some other place. There will be a list where all the state names will be captured. So it just needs to pick up the list from that place. Because if tomorrow there is a new state which is created in India, for example, you can't go and change it on every screen if there are multiple screens created. So in that case, it will be designed in such a manner that only there will be only one place where you go and modify, and it will start getting reflected at all the places where state dropdown has been used. For the first name, what is the rule? It's a mandatory field. For middle name, there is no rule because it's not a mandatory field. Typically, middle names are not mandatory. Last name is mandatory because in a lot of states, last name is mandatory. In a lot of states, last name is not mandatory. Date of birth, mandatory. So whatever are the rules associated with each of the fields also gets captured. So if you just quickly go back and see, there are four things which you have done. One, detailing the broad level requirements given by customer. Process flow, screen diagrams, and then field level detailing. These are four things which is typically done in the requirements phase. There could be a little more, there could be a little less, depending on the scenario, which we are going to do ultimately later on. So now, if you look at the software development process, first step, this is what you are responsible to create. So at the end of the requirements phase, you will have a document which will have all these details for every screen and every process which is to be developed. So now this is given to the technology team. So you, your job, active job, stops here and you give it to the technology team for designing it. Okay. Now what happens in design? What do you mean by design? Any idea about what is design in software?
I guess it mainly deals with the look and feel of the software.
Okay. Anything else?
Can also be the wireframe, as in the workflow and everything. How is that to happen?
Okay. See, this is called wireframe.
Right.
Okay. So wireframes are created before the design. So what you are saying is that design is more relevant in the context of web design. Okay, where you're designing the screen. Okay. This right. design which we are talking about in software is different, and it means it's a pretty important task, as important as the business analyst carrying out the requirements task. Okay, it's a very elaborate and a detailed process. So what happens in design? So design phase starts with the decision on architecture and platform, meaning do you want to develop in a Microsoft environment? Do you want to develop it using Java? Do you want to develop using PHP? For this particular solution, what is the best platform? So once you decide it's a web-based system, then you have to decide which platform to use. .NET, Java, PHP, AngularJS, there's so many of them which needs to be discussed and rationalized. Okay. Then architecture.
So who decides this, that which platform to be used?
This is the technical. So there is a team which is called design team led by technical architect.
So business analyst will not choose that, right?
No, no, not at all. Business, business analyst job stops at the requirements phase temporarily. Okay. So they hand it over to the design team, but they are in the initial meetings, they sit, because design team is designing a solution which is required by a customer for a particular case. It is not something which is universal design, right? So they are doing it in a context. So your inputs will be required, but you are not executing the design.
Okay.
Okay. So for example, what is an architecture mean? Architecture's meaning. Architecture means if, so for example, let's say you expect huge traffic for this website, millions of hits per day, like Flipkart, like Amazon, versus you have to design a system where you expect 10 to 15 users per day. There is a huge difference the way architectural decisions are taken for these two systems. Okay, so it's important for them to get this data from you, that whether it's going to be huge traffic or very low traffic. So whether focus should shift to designing a very fast system or efficient system. That is, these are the things which are considered during the design phase, first part of design phase. Also, if somebody, let's say deaf and dumb, this system is designed for deaf and dumb people or people who are little handicapped, either they are blind, they have a motion problem, that means they can't move their fingers and all, then how will you take care of them? So there are certain principles of architecting systems based on accessibility design principles. So that's a different ballgame altogether. So you have to consider those factors also. So depending on what is the context of the system uses, architectural and design decisions are taken. So that is the broad level design phase. Next, how to store data? Because most of the systems require to store data for later use. So somebody has applied for LPG connection. That data is not temporary. It is stored. Like I have made this PPT. This is not going to get destroyed after I finish this session today. I can always reuse this PPT whenever I want. Similarly, in a software system, when data is entered by the users, it has to be stored somewhere. It cannot be saved on the browser because you close the browser. You can destroy the system or stop using this system. But if you go to a new system, still you want to have this data. That means there has to be a place where data is stored, but it's a central location and not dependent on end user's machine or the platform. So the how the data is stored, that is also a decision which is taken during the design phase. Also, you don't want to duplicate data. I mean, you don't want to have data which unnecessarily occupies redundant space. Okay, these are the decisions which are taken. Thirdly, how do you add rules? So now you have seen the rules which we have created. So some fields are mandatory. Date of birth cannot be more than today's date, right? I mean, or depending on the criteria as to if the applicant is supposed to be 18 years of age, 21 years of age, that's a rule which has to be implemented. So how will you write the rules? Okay. So all these decisions are taken during the design phase. Let's look at, this is the data which is supposed to be captured by the system. This is another system which is and this represents the orders of the customer on an e-commerce website. So these are the people who have placed orders on different dates for different products, which was available at that point in time for a particular price. Okay. Now, if you look at this data, can you observe something which is not correct?
Yeah, I can see a duplicate entry here.
Which column?
The first one.
The names, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you see it in the product column also?
Yes.
Right. So, yeah.
When the design. Yeah,
amount is also duplicated, but amount is something which is changing because typically on
I mean to say, for the same product, the amount is different.
Yeah, correct point. So you are seeing three problems with this table where there are five fields actually. Name, they are duplicate names. Order products, they are different, similar products repeated. And for similar products, the pricing are different. Now, the design team typically looks at these structures. Okay. So now these data tables, if you remember, we discussed in the very first class saying that data modeling is one of the parts, one of the skills or one of the activities which may have to be done by the business analyst. So you might have to provide some kind of data structure to the customer, to the design team. When they look at this, they realize that if we, let's say for example, today in this 8 to 10 rows, you have Prashant's name coming 3 times, Shrijit Nair's name coming twice. Okay, if you have millions of rows, there could be possibility of millions of records getting duplicated. That means we are unnecessarily creating duplication of data, and we are also using more space than required. Okay, I will show you how. Same thing here, where the product names are getting repeated here. So how do they reduce the space requirement in the data structures? So what they do is, So look at these names. Okay. So a proper ID is given to the names, and other details are captured. Sorry, I think the name, the column is wrong. But what is done here is, the customers are stored in a separate place, or the customer names, and only the customer code is getting used here. So instead of using the full name of the customer, we are only using a small identifier for the customer. This is one of the tasks which is done by the design team. So this is done for product also in the same manner. So there is a product which has a standard name and standard pricing. And here, when somebody orders, you only capture the product ID and the amount. Now, why amount is captured here? Because this pricing keeps on changing based on various offers which the companies launch. So Independence Day offer, there is a discount. So instead of 13,500 on that day, you can have available at 12,000 rupees. So if somebody buys that product, you can have it at 12,000 rupees. While on the other day, if you buy the same product, it might be available for 13,000. Okay. So the amount may vary depending on the offers, but the data which can be reduced to a minimum size, as far as redundancy is concerned, that part is done by the design team. So this is an additional thing which is done by the design team. Is that clear?
Yes.
So in the design phase, we have seen what? Sarthak, you are asking something?
Yeah, I have a question. Like if we are replacing customer names with customer IDs, so does it save space by using lesser characters? Is that what we are trying to do?
Both. Two things. It's not only that. That is also one of the important points. Okay. You can see that Prashant Balgurgi is using 3, 8, 9, some 15 to 20 characters. Okay.
Right.
Now we are using 5 characters. That is one. But more importantly, see, that is one part of it. So you are definitely saving space, but nowadays space is not a big problem in terms of pricing. What is more important is, for example, let's say, look at the product scenario. Product has a particular display name saying that Nexus S216GB. Tomorrow the company says, no, I want to change this product's name. Okay. And instead of S200, we have made it S201, whatever. Now, if you don't have this kind of a scenario, what will happen is, all the orders which were placed on Nexus S200 will require a change to reflect the correct product name. Right?
Okay.
Similarly, if the customer decides that my name, which is showing, is not correct, I want to change it. My last name, probably I wrongly entered or something happened. So he goes and change it. Now again, if he has placed already few orders, system has to now go back and change the entire table, which is the important order table. And the order table will be having millions of records because everything is created here. So changing data in a table which has multiple rows takes a lot of time and time consuming process as well. Okay, so it's not only saves the space, but more importantly, it makes it little more efficient in terms of working with these systems.
Okay.
So this is what happens in design phase. So we have seen what happens in requirements phase. Then we have seen what happens in the design phase. Now, third phase is the requirements phase. Sorry, the coding phase. So after the design team has completed the design part, they then give it to the development team saying that, okay, you start writing the programs. Now, look at it from a programmer perspective. When I have to write code so that everything comes alive in terms of what was conceptualized, I will need two, three things. One, I need to know how the screen looks like and what are the different fields which are available, what are the rules on those fields. So if the name has to be mandatory, I need to write code so that if a person tries to submit the application without entering the first name, I need to check and stop him before the data is saved, right? Third thing, I would like to know as a coder, where will I save my data? If somebody entered and said submit, everything is fine, I need to store it somewhere. So I need to know this structure. As to all my orders are going to be in one place, and I have to put the reference for the order product and for the name by looking at these two places, which are products list and customers list. Without this, it is not possible to write code. Code, you know, it's like this, something like this. It looks like this. Okay, now coding is again, it's a pretty involved job. It takes a lot of time, and different platforms will involve different amounts of coding. Some platforms are such that it requires a lot of coding for small things. There are certain platforms where minimal amount of coding is required to be done for achieving the same task. So it depends, and based on that, the amount of coding, the time of coding will be determined. So after the coding is done, the code testing will happen. Okay. So in the code testing, a lot of things are done in terms of whether the every line of code sometimes is checked. So if you are developing a software which is to be used in an aircraft, then every line of code is used. Nowadays, aircrafts are completely automated. Everything is software driven. Okay. So, and you can't afford to have any error whatsoever. Right. So that means every line of code which is written by the programmer has to be tested thoroughly. Versus the code which is written for commercial applications for various services to be offered to the end users. In that case, testing is selective. Code testing is selectively done, and we try and see how much percentage of the code has to be tested. So there are tools which are available for doing these kind of testing. Okay. So when somebody is doing code level testing, they do two types of things. One is the testing based on the line of code written. Number two, the testing done based on the functionality of the system. So the moment we talk about the functionality, you again now get start in again get involved for doing the functionality test. So your job will be testing the system from end to end without looking at the code. Okay, so the coders have done their bit of testing, the system is ready. You have to enter data and see whether it is happening correctly as expected. So after the technical team and the business analyst team have done their bit of testing, then it is given to the customer for their bit of testing. And that is called user acceptance testing. So user acceptance testing is primarily the testing which is carried out by customers. Okay. In terms of technique or in terms of the way it is done, it is not very different from the testing which is carried out by business analysts. Okay, it's more or less the same technique which is used. So you write test cases and you conduct the testing of the system. Okay, so this is as far as a typical software activity, software development activities are concerned. Any clarifications, any questions, any thoughts?
But this user acceptance test would be done by us and as well as customer?
No. User acceptance test typically is done by users. But see what happens in some cases, you will see that the customers outsource it, meaning they ask business analysts to do it for them rather than they doing themselves. Because many times customers don't have the right people with them to conduct these kind of tests. So that is also a scenario where you will have these cases. You will be doing the testing on behalf of customer as well. But large customers like Citibank, like Bank of America, or banks, typically banks and financial institutions, they have pretty evolved IT teams. Okay, so banks are typically, or rather BFSI segment, are typically leaders in IT implementations and IT users. Okay, so they have a team of fully qualified IT professionals also. Okay, so they undertake it themselves. They don't give it to vendors, business analysts. Does that clarify?
Yes.